God. Amen. Everything that we have need of today, He can meet it simultaneously and not even stretch His abilities.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Thank God for who He is and what He is able to do. We want to go to the Lord in prayer this morning in beginning the service. I know that there are needs that you have experienced, things going on in people's lives. I know most all of you know, but I'd encourage you to please pray for my mother-in-law. She fell this week and broke her hip and had to have a hip surgery and a replacement. And took her a couple of days to come out of anesthesia to even be able to talk, but she still cannot swallow. And her speech is very slurred. And so please pray for her that she... I prayed for her this morning. I went and seen her and prayed for her this morning. And don't know if it's her time, but if it is, that she would have a peaceful passing. But if it's not her time, I'm asking God to give her a full recovery. Amen. So please help us pray with us about that. Amen. If you have a need today, that something's heavy on your heart, would you just lift a hand? Amen. I just ask that we would all pray for one another. And maybe you might even feel comfortable to just reach over and touch someone and pray for them that raised a hand. Heavenly Father, we thank you today that you are a loving God. You're a caring Savior. Thank you, God, that you are our hope in this world. And I ask God today that you would please meet the needs. Everyone that raised a hand, Lord, was representative of something that is heavy on their heart, some need that is fresh on their minds today. And I'm asking, God, would you please intervene for them? Come on the scene. Do what needs to be done. Let your will be done, God, in every situation, every relationship that's strained, every lost
promises that he's made to us. I want the devil to hear it, amen. Sometimes I want my doubting mind to hear it too, amen.
Yes, amen.
Worship the Lord today.
If it's written in the Bible, I'll believe it till I die. Though the mountains be removed and cast into the sea, God's word will last throughout eternity. Amen. I mean, let's sing that chorus. I want to sing that chorus. Help me get started. Amen. Well, let's get out and greet each other to the house of the Lord this morning. Shake hands with somebody. Let them know you're glad to see them today. Upped our sound. We're trying to get it to where the people online can hear as well as the people in here, and we've had gaps. We've been told because the organ wasn't mic'd and the drums weren't mic'd and we didn't have the proper equalizing of sound that sometimes the online singing and the sound was a little tinny. Anyway, I hope and pray that that we're not blasting you out here this morning. Bryce got here this morning, he was hitting the bass, and I was back there in the nursing mother's room, and it was rattling the windows, and I said, this ain't going to work. but anyway, I'll have to, y'all will have to give me some feedback of how how it sounds online. I appreciate it. I can't hardly stand to listen to myself preach. It's hard for me to listen to myself preach. So that's why I say to y'all, thank y'all for coming to listen to me preach, because sometimes I don't even like it. No, I'm just kidding. I don't hear myself as being Southern until I hear myself on recording. And then I was like, man, that guy's right out of the South. He's out of the Deep South. When it comes across here, it don't sound like that. But whenever I'm on a recording, I sound different. Anyway. Well, Brother Wells, would you come and help us receive the offering this morning? Appreciate you and Brother Robert. Amen. I made mention last week of how that the winters are tough for many people who do landscaping and have seasonal jobs. But God is faithful, and he has met our needs. And he has kept us going, kept us alive, kept us fed. And as far as I can tell, y'all been eating good. And you look good. And so thank the Lord for his blessings. Please be faithful to the Lord in your giving. Amen. Brother Wells, would you pray over the offering?
Praise you, Lord Jesus. Give unto you. Already, Lord, we give back unto you, Lord, what you've already given us, Lord Jesus. But bless these tithes, bless these.
Somebody said they did. Thank you, Sister Sori. Appreciate that. This time we're going to dismiss the kids for Children's Church. Got a good group of kids today. Now see how they're excited to get down to Kids Church? That's the way all of us need to feel about getting to church, right? I mean, I'm not, you can't wait to get there. Sister Jeanette, you're not a kid. Sister Heather, you're not a kid. Oh, you're not going good. Good, good, good. Brother Steve, are you going to sing a song for us today? You are? Let's do it. I can't wait.
Out that. Amen. I'm going to sing How Great Thou Art this morning. Amen. He's awesome, isn't he? Stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. And when I think that God is Son, sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. Shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, how great thou art, how great thou art.
God is great and greatly to be praised. And I was thinking this week along the lines of that song as to why it seems to be so apparent to some of God's greatness and so aloof and hidden to others of God's greatness. Why do some only see what they wish God would be, and others can see His greatness? I want to be in the camp of those that can see His goodness, don't you? And recognize how good He is to me. Amen. Thank you, musicians. Y'all can feel free to go down. I will not endeavor to do any more singing this morning. I want to ask all of you to please pray. Sister Sori, would you tell us, did Brother Ty's cousin pass away? Yes. Did he drive? Did he drive? He drove. Yeah. Let's pray for Brother Ty that God would let the family would find comfort, and that Brother Ty could have safe travels. Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, if you would, please turn with me to Proverbs chapter 23. And we're going to begin at verse 23. Proverbs 23 and 23. And if you would stand, please, for the reading of God's Word. Amen. I want to be a blessing this morning to you if I can at all. The Bible says, buy the truth and sell it not. Also wisdom and instruction and understanding. The father of the righteous shall greatly rejoice, and he that begetteth a wise child shall have joy of him. The father and thy mother shall be glad, and she that bear thee shall rejoice. And she that bear thee shall rejoice. And now verse 26 is my text verse. My son, give me thine heart, and let thine eyes observe my ways. If the Lord will help me today, I want to preach to you just on the simple thought. Give me your heart. Give me your heart. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I ask this morning that you'd make me a blessing. Let the words that I say find a fertile heart to receive them. Give us ears to hear what your Spirit is really wanting to say today to us. Don't let us be dull of hearing or hard of hearing. Don't let us be resistant to the Word of God, but let us be receptive to it. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I would like to begin by just telling you a little story of something that, a conversation that I had this week with my oldest son, Joshua. This week, our twin babies have a birthday. Lauren, how old will they be? Five? Six. They'll be six this week. And Josh and Kayla were taking the twins to some, I don't know, some trampoline place where they could all jump off the walls and I don't know what this place is called, but anyway, it brought back memories. I did my time at Chuck E. Cheese with all the birthdays and stuff, and it's all a scam to get your money. But anyway, we as parents, we do these things to make our kids enjoy their childhood and have memories, good memories. And the kids were all excited about going, and Josh and I had a moment of how that time flies and couldn't believe that they're already, you know, in school. The twins, the little ones, are already in school. And letting them have what a treasure it is today for kids that can be raised with a mom and dad, and especially with a mom and dad that love God and are trying to put godly values in kids and all. And Josh said something to me that just melted my heart. He said, well, I try every single night to go in and hug my girls and tell them I love them, kiss them, and just let them know I love them. And I told him, I said, well, son, I said, you're doing their future mates a wonderful service to be raised unmolested and having affection from a man and knowing how to receive that and give that, and you're training them well. And he said something to me that is the basis of my message this morning. He said, well, Dad, he said, thank you for y'all giving that to me. And he said, I want to give it to them because I want them to give me their heart. Because the time will come when they'll give their heart to a man. And when that time comes, I would like to have an opportunity to speak into that decision some, to spare them from some heartache. And I told him, I said, well, you're extremely wise, because girls want to give their hearts to their daddies. I know my sister did. My dad, I grew up with a little bit of resentment because he had to beat me to get me to conform. And he'd tell Lisa, you better straighten up, and she'd just start shaking, and she got out of so many whippings because she knew that she had her daddy's heart wrapped around her little finger. And that seems to be the way it goes when these girls start to cry and pucker up to cry, that their daddies just, they just melt. And but when Joshua said, I want them to give me their heart, I was reminded of this verse. The Lord said, give me thine heart and let thine eyes observe my ways. Our hearts are strange things. We hear people talk about following your heart. We hear people talk about guarding your heart. We hear a lot of things regarding our hearts. But this is a strange, strange, strange request that God has made of us to give him our hearts. And I want to talk about that for a minute. Number one, it's strange because of who's making the request. Why would God desire anything that I had to offer, much less my heart? And you might say, well, Brother Gary, why do you say that? He's the creator of all. What could he possibly desire of us? What does God have to gain by asking us to give him our hearts? Much less our hearts, because our hearts are messed up. Our hearts are broken. He could say, give me your talent. And surely that wouldn't impress him because it came from him, but at least it would be something that we're good at, right? He could say, give me your offering. And that wouldn't really do a lot for him, but at least it would indicate that that we're willing to obey and sacrifice. But why did he say, "Give me your heart"? Now you have to understand what your heart is really in order to see just how strange this is. In Jeremiah 17 and 9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doing. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Why would God want our hearts? Why is this such a strange request? Because of sin. Sin corrupts a pure heart. The reason that you come to church is because we're striving for the good. We see wickedness. We see evil in this world. But we think there's a path to goodness. We think there's a path to righteousness. And so we come to hear the Word of God preached to us. We come to get influenced to do right because sin has corrupted our hearts. Sin has broken our hearts with feelings of shame and regret. I'm gonna read something that I wrote here, and I may have to read it twice just for you to kind of get your to understand my thought process. Because of sin, our hearts are broken. Feelings of shame and regret fill our hearts. And instead of responding with humility and repentance, which would open the door to forgiveness and restoration, we opt for pride and stubbornness. Turn produces more brokenness, more disappointment. At what point we are now easy prey for bitterness to enter our hearts, for anger to enter our hearts, desire for revenge, and even ultimately hatred. You see, the heart is designed to love, not to hate. It has the capacity to hate, but it wasn't made to do that. It wasn't made to feel vengeful. It wasn't made to be driven and motivated by anger. The heart was not designed by God originally to be that. But because of sin, we struggle with all of these emotions in our hearts. We struggle when an offense comes our way. We struggle to forgive. We struggle to let go. We struggle to act in mercy, but we guard our hearts. We retreat. And we are left to suffer in our brokenness by ourselves, which in turn only produces more frustration and more frustration. Am I talking to anybody this morning? So why would God want our hearts? It's a strange request. The thing about me that is the most broken, God says, give me that. I don't know why he would want it. Surely, it must be for our benefit and not his own. In his love for us, he desires to share the joys of giving with us. In Acts 20, in verse 35, the Bible says, I have showed you all things, how that so laboring ye ought to support the weak and to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. A heart that receives love but never learns to give love will surely become spoiled and rotten and ultimately good for nothing. Have you seen people today that they're all about receiving love but they've never learned to give love? So when God says, give me your heart, love seeks to be loved. God is loving us by saying, give me your heart, because he wants to share the joys of giving with us. It is more blessed to give than to receive. And lest I go any further and forget this to say, I thought of this morning whenever I was having final thoughts put together. I would say to the young people today, be careful who you give your heart to. Be careful who you give your heart to. Don't give your heart to just anyone. Don't give your heart to someone that's just a taker. You see, lust disguises itself so many times as love. That boy that says, oh, I love you, I love you, I love you, and then wants to put his hands all over you and take away something that's precious from you. Be careful not to give your heart away to the person or people that are not worthy of it. Amen. But God, the lover of our soul, the one that is worthy of all adoration and all approval, He is requesting our heart. He is requesting that we give Him our heart, not out of some selfish gain, because He has nothing to gain from it. Brother Dave, there's nothing that's appealing about our hearts. There's nothing that He would be bettered by having our hearts. The only logical conclusion that could be come to, the reason He says, give me your heart, is because He wants us to experience the joy of giving. You see, God so loved that He gave. Giving is the expression of love. Love seeks to be loved. You wouldn't want someone to give you their heart that you was not willing to love. Matter of fact, it would be almost reproachful or an embarrassment for someone to love you that you were not willing to love back. I know why people get attached to dogs, because dogs just are so willing to give you their hearts. I mean, as much as they can, they are excited to be in your presence. They want to be touched by you. They want your affection. They're willing to give you their affection, deserved or undeserved. I mean, without any reservation or hesitation, they just give you their love. And you're a cruel person if you don't reciprocate. So it is with God. God first loved us. Can you say thank God He first loved us? He didn't wait for us to act like we wanted His love. He didn't say, you know what, if you'll show me a little indication that you want it, I got great things for you. God so loved that in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. He bestowed His love upon us when we were so unworthy of it. It's a strange request for God to ask for our hearts. So why would God want it? I've told you why He shouldn't want it. I've told you why it doesn't make any logical sense, why He would desire it. But why would He want our hearts? Number one, hearts are made to feel, to love, to motivate us towards good. Hearts are made to feel. I preached a message one time about I can still feel. I used Brother Bloom in that as an example in that message. I love it when Brother Bloom cries in the preaching. I loved seeing the Spirit of God touch Brother Bloom and tears still run down. It ain't many 70-something-year-old men that have that ability to cry anymore, to be touched. And it seems as though the closer you get to the end, you either go real soft or real hard. There's not a lot of in-between ground, right? Life has either hardened you or you've allowed your heart to still remain pliable. I'm struck with the feeling, with the verse where Jesus said about the people that heard the truth. He said, we piped and you wouldn't dance. We lamented and you wouldn't mourn. You were past feeling. The reason that speakers tell emotional stories and they try to bring personal examples into their preaching, because I don't know how everybody is, but I know I am trying to make an emotional connection with you so that your spirit is open so that you can receive. God gave us a heart, and that heart is supposed to feel. It's supposed to cry when bad things happen. It's supposed to laugh and be joyous when good things happen. And why would God want our hearts? because he knows what our hearts were intended for. God sees our potential, not our past. And God knows what we could be if our hearts belonged to him. God knows what we could be if our hearts truly belonged to him. Let me say that one more time. God knows what we could be if our hearts truly belonged to him. You understand what I'm talking about when you give someone your heart, right? You understand what, if we gave our hearts fully to God, I mean, not just repented of our sins and said, okay, now I can get up and I'm good for the next 6 days and I'll come back next week and we'll deal with it again. No, but if I give God my heart, the potential that's unleashed. Because you see, God is the great mender. God can fix what's broken. Give me thine heart. It seems to be the core of the issue. Love seeks to be loved in return. We cannot be loved by those. We care not to be loved by those that who do not love in return. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 4, the Bible says, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. And on to the final point. I said, number one, God's strange request of us to give him our hearts. Secondly, we talked about why would God want our hearts. And then thirdly, I want to talk to you about the great reward of giving God our hearts. Why does this preacher get up here and say, give God your heart? Why would I want to express to you, God is worthy of you giving him your heart? Why would I tell you, it would be in your best interest to give God your heart? Why? Because there's great reward when we do. I have 5 sub-points here. Ride with me here. What is the reward of God having our hearts? Number one, God can and will fix what's broken in your heart. God can and will fix what's broken in your heart. You remember what we talked about, how that most people's heart is full of bitterness? If you give God your heart, he won't let that bitterness stay there. I'm really feeling the need to connect now. Bitterness, in many cases, is a coping mechanism. You get hurt, you build walls. You get behind those walls and you say, won't let that happen again. And while you feel safe behind that wall, you're now exposed to a whole other enemy called bitterness. That root of bitterness starts to grow in your life. That feeling of protecting yourself gets stronger and stronger and stronger, and you isolate yourself more and more and more. And while you're not willing to be hurt anymore, neither can you feel love anymore. And so it winds up hurting you in the end. It destroys your joy, destroys your purpose. All in the name of you protecting yourself. That's what God does, though. You give God your heart. And it seems like those people that aggravated you and you're bitter towards, it seems like that they're still my enemy. I'm still guarded. But every now and then, very patiently, the Lord starts tapping you on the shoulder and said, pray for those that despitefully use you. Do good to those that curse you. And he starts bringing up messages, and that's one reason you need to come and hear a preacher preach to you, because you'd gravitate to the things that make you feel good. But every now and then the Lord says, I got something I want to talk to you about. And every now and then it just comes to the surface, and before long it becomes you or Isaac, or it's me and you. And then you have to make another trip back to the altar and say, God, I give you my heart. I give you my heart. I recommit myself to you. You're my first love. You're my first priority. I give you my heart. And then the Lord starts changing your heart. And you don't think as evil and bad about those people anymore. And you can really start to have a paradigm shift. And you can think, well, they did that because they were lashing out. And that feeling of anger and resentment turns to compassion. My wife said something this week about her mother being in the shape she's in. Why do Christian people have to suffer? My poor little mother-in-law's body's just given up. Her bones are brittle. She fell the other day, and she was in the she was just sitting in the living room about 4:30 in the morning and hollering for help. I went in there. She said, "I can't get up. I can't get up." And she was just sitting down. She said, "I just can't get up." Then when she fell and broke her ribs, and then she fell and broke her wrist, and then she fell and broke her hip, and a lot of suffering is happening here at the end. And I told my wife, I said, "Honey, the thing we have to keep in mind is to the sinner, man, this life is the only heaven they'll ever experience. But to the saint, this is the only hell we'll ever go through." David struggled with that question. Why? Why is there no pains in the death of the wicked? And we seem to suffer all the way through this life. And the Bible says, "They that would live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." It's not because God is mean. God is trying his best to do everything he can to bring people into relationship with him. And one great reward of giving God my heart, if God has my heart, he will fix what's broken in my heart. He will take away bitterness. He will take away anger. Now you have to understand something. All of you that's in this room that you say, "I have given God my heart," you have to continue to do that. It's just like a marriage. You can't say, "Well, I was at the altar and I told you I love you. If I change my mind, I'll let you know." You can't live life like that. You got to constantly be recommitting yourself, constantly be giving yourself away. But if you do that, if you give God your heart and you continue to give him your heart, he will change what's broken in you. I recommend Jesus to anybody who's broken. I recommend Jesus to everybody who's hurting. I recommend Jesus. You can't follow from afar off and have this happen, though. You can't say, "God, I give you my heart, but oh, that person, you can't touch that person. That situation is off limits to you. You can't do that." You have to fully give your heart to Jesus. First of all, it's a reward of those that give God their heart. God will fix what's broken in your heart. Secondly, if there's parts of your heart that are not fixable, God will give you a new heart. In Ezekiel 36 and 26, it says, "A heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them." How does a person give their heart away? We're told today in society that a heart loves who it loves. You have no control over it. That's hogwash. You can give your heart. The way you give your heart is when infatuation comes, you meet someone and there's just an initial connection of like-mindedness or good conversation or whatever. You give your heart by spending time and mental energy with and on that person. That's the reason I tell you guys every week, read your Bible every day this week. You're spending mental energy giving your heart to God. Amen. You're spending time with him in prayer. And he becomes increasingly lovely as time goes on. But when you don't spend time, let's say you met somebody and you just really felt a connection, you just felt close and like you were just ready to just be all in and give yourself to them, but then you went away, they went away, you got busy, they got busy, there was no connection, there was no interaction, there was no communication, that person don't get your heart. At the very best, you just had a moment in time. You had a connection for a moment, but you didn't give your heart. They didn't give their heart. Giving your heart is a continual investment that you make. Amen. Thirdly, number one, God can fix and will fix what's broken about your heart. And God will give you a new heart. Thirdly, the great benefit, the great reward of giving God our heart is this. God will restore your heart to perform its purpose, which is to love. You see, God is not content with a heart that does not love. God is not satisfied with a heart that does not care and does not have the emotions that it should have. Read 1 Corinthians 13. It'll show you what love does. It's gentle, kind. It doesn't vaunt itself. It doesn't look out for itself. Love is giving. And God, it is His divine nature so much that if you give Him your heart, He will make your heart able to love again. Brother Eddie preached Friday night about if God wrote your epitaph, what would He say? And he mentioned in that sermon that he had heard me say over and over and over again, the thing that I would love to be remembered for more than anything else is that He loved greatly. He loved greatly. I realize today, standing before you, I will not have the capacity or the ability or even desire to love unless God has my heart. This world produces self-centered, selfish, self-seeking people. That's what this world produces. Love is the opposite of that. And the only way that I will be able to love is if God gives me love and He changes my heart and gives me a desire to love others. God will restore my heart to perform His intention. In Titus chapter 2 and verse 3, listen to this. Well, let's go to Ephesians chapter 5. Let's talk about husbands and wives just a minute. Ephesians 5, I heard John MacArthur mention this verse, and he said, I'm about to make at least half the people mad in this room as I discuss to you what God's intention for marriage is. And he said about several dozen people got up and walked out when he was preaching this message because it is not politically correct. In Ephesians 5 and 25, it says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave Himself for it. In another verse, it said, husbands, love your wives and be not bitter towards them. That's amazing. That's just a command. Love your wives like Christ loved the church and gave Himself for it. You ladies, wouldn't you love for your husbands to love you that way? Just to give Himself for you? So much, always putting your best interest ahead of His own. Wouldn't you love that? Listen to what the Bible says in Titus chapter 2 and verse 3. The aged women, likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness. Not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. We're talking about older women here. They're supposed to become holiness. Not false accusers, not given to wine, teachers of good things. And in verse 4, that they may teach the young women to be sober and to love their husbands and to love their children. Now, you can look around today and you can see that the natural affection from mothers to children is in great peril in our country. Otherwise, we wouldn't have the abortion problem. We wouldn't have the abandonment issues. What should be natural affections is being lost. How does that happen? It happens by life being self-absorbed. It becoming all about the mother's pleasure, all about what they want to do. And kids are looked at as a nuisance. I want to go to the party. I want to go to the bar, but I got to do something with my kid. But packed in that verse, it says that they may teach the young women to be sober and to love their husbands. To love their husbands. You older women, you should have figured out how to love your husbands so you could teach these younger women how to love their husbands. Just like I told my son, you're doing your future son-in-laws a great service by loving your daughters. You older women, you need to be teaching the younger women by the example that you show to love their husbands. What was the purpose of a heart? To love. We are portraying a picture of marriage in this country today that this is someone that's just going to help you along in your own aspirations and your own desires, and they're going to fulfill you. Instead of, God's going to put somebody in my life that's going to rub me the wrong way, that's going to cause me to learn to humble myself and learn the lessons that I need to learn and give of myself. And if you don't both share that same view of life and put the Lord at the front of it, it's going to be messed up. The last point is this. Well, the second to the last point is this. Fourthly, what is the great reward of giving God our hearts? To give God our hearts is to give our hearts to the Lord, is to deposit it in a safe place where it can be taken care of. I said to you young people at the onset of this message, don't give your heart to people who are not worthy of keeping it. I was reminded of a saying whenever I was thinking about this, and I'd like for you to hear it. He is no fool to give what he cannot keep in order to gain what he cannot lose. He is no fool to give what he cannot keep. You see, friends, you're going to serve somebody. You're going to love somebody. You will. Jesus said, no man can serve two masters. Either he'll do one to the other or the other to the other. I mean, it is going to be, you're going to deposit your affection and your love and your commitment to someone or something. God is the safest place to put the treasure of your heart into. It seems as though the commitment is great. He said in one place, if you don't come and hate your father and mother, you're not worthy of me. He demands all. He will be Lord of all or not Lord at all. But if you deposit your heart into God, give it to God, it's the safest place that your heart could be. I see people who they get so emotionally attached to sports teams. I understand that. I did that as a young man. And you stay frustrated most all the time. Right? How many teams are in the NFL? 32? Is that right? Or is there more now? Is that right? 32? Do you realize that 30 out of those teams are not going to go to the Super Bowl? You got a 30-1 chance that your team is going to go. Those odds are pathetic. No, there's nothing wrong with watching a football game. There's nothing wrong with, you know, being a casual fan. But I see people get so invested. They bet thousands of dollars. I mean, their whole world gets turned upside down whenever, you know, their star player gets hurt or some referee. I've heard people cussing referees out. It's a foolish thing to put your, invest your heart in places that you're just setting yourself up for such disappointment. Amen. Can I just tell you, ladies, don't put your heart in your looks. You ought to look the best you can, but your identity is not in your looks. I mean, I see these people nowadays, they spend all this money on Botox and plastic surgeries. Hey, you're not doing yourself a lot of service. And can I just let you ladies in on a secret? Most men don't care. Your smile and your affection does way more than how red your lips are or how well your makeup is put on. Don't invest your heart into things that are just fading and fading and fading. You've seen that 85-year-old woman that's all dolled up, and you're like, honey, the wrinkles are still showing. Huh? Some people put their heart in their possessions, in the abundance of things which they possess. Oh, look at my new car. Look at my new toy. Look at this and the other. Oh, I tell you what, that's a slippery slope. You spend 3 hours out there cleaning that truck, and then they send you to Menzer. One trip into Menzer is gone. I had a truck the other day. We had spent all that time cleaning. One trip into Menzer, brown. Or worse yet, get that new car, go to the restaurant or the grocery store, somebody pushes their buggy, first scratch. I see these people. You got their new car all shined up, and they go way out in the parking lot. Park way out there so nobody can touch their car. That damn buggy gets more speed now to hit you. But how people love their stuff. Isn't that amazing? They just put all this emotional energy in. Look what I got. Look what I got. Did you know it's fading? Moth and rust, and the thief breaks through and steals. It's fading. Life stinks. I mean, like one guy said, he said, the older you get furniture disease. Your chest falls down into your drawers. You know, you used to have muscles, and now they're sagging. Everything's sagging, going south. Hey, invest your heart in a safe place. God is trustworthy. Could I just brag on Jesus for a moment? He's never treated me unkind, not once. I've done some very disappointing things. And I've come humbly back to Him and said, Lord, I'm sorry. And He's never exposed me. He's never humiliated me. He's never belittled me. He's never treated me unkind, ever. Boy, I tell you what, how many of you have told people secrets and you thought, you found out that was a bad, bad, bad mistake? They weren't trustworthy. Being a preacher is a huge responsibility. I know very private things about a lot of people, and I pray to God that I always walk trustworthy of people's secrets. But listen to me, friend. You want the safest place. Jesus is the safest place. Amen. And the Bible says confession is good for the soul. So you can get alone I would recommend turn your phone off because Google's listening. And they may be listening even when the phone is off. I don't know. I learned some pretty wild things about AI this week that I won't go into. But you get alone somewhere and you can empty your heart to God, and He's going to treat you with respect, and he's going to deal with you kindly. Hey, give your heart to the Lord. Give your heart to the Lord. I hope and pray that you're sensing the heart of this preacher. You see, I want you to know I love you, but I'm a human and I'm going to fail. No doubt, if we walk closely, I will aggravate you. I will frustrate you. My flaws will start to show through. My inadequacies will start to be glaring to some of you. Even though you know I love you and you love me, we will have tension. We will have, it will not remain harmonious forever. But God, He overlooks what needs to be overlooked. He doesn't overlook what does not need to be overlooked. He is patient with us. He is kind to us. He is long-suffering to us. He is convicting to us. He is training us. And the last point of the message is this, and I hope you hear this. If we give God our heart, to give God our hearts is the secret to enjoying the service of the Lord. Many people, listen to this last closing statement, many people have just enough religion to not enjoy the pleasures of sin, but not enough to enjoy the surrender of serving Christ. If you live halfway in, you will be miserable. You'll have just enough knowledge to know that God's not pleased with your sin. You'll have just enough religion to know and feel bad when you do something wrong. And your conscience will constantly be gnawing at you. It's a miserable place to be. But you won't have enough to enjoy the service and surrender to Christ. You gotta give God your heart. You're not here to prove to me that you love Jesus. You're not here to impress me. You're not here to somehow convince me that, hey, I'm committed. You're going to stand before the Lord. Not me. I'm not your judge. I'm just your fellow passenger. We're walking this journey together. That's all I am. I'm just an encourager. Come on. Let's give our lives to the Lord. That's the reason I tell you kids, you young people. You kids, I got to start calling y'all young people now. Y'all were kids when I met you, but you're not kids now. The reason I tell you over and over, if you surrender now, you won't have to go through the heartache that most of these people have went through. If these people could tell you the story of how they was hooked on drugs and they're on their second or third marriage and how that all the family dynamics have changed and the ruin that Satan has caused in their lives, they would scream with me, give your heart to Jesus completely now. Don't play a game. I have done my best today to tell you why I thought it was a strange request why God would want our hearts, because we're messed up. But if we would, why it would be a great reward to us if we would give Him our hearts. I have said to you already in this message, if you've not given your heart to Christ, He's trustworthy. You can trust Him. You can give Him your heart. And I have said to you in this message, if you have given Him your heart, you have to continue to do it over and over and over again. Because the strange thing about this old life is we start wanting to take back possessions We start wanting to take back old offenses. We start wanting to fall back into old habits. We start wanting to stand up for ourselves. We start wanting to do all the things that cause the pain in the first place. We naturally gravitate to that. So we have to constantly come and say, Lord, I give you my heart. Stand if you would, please. God told me to love my wife. God told me to give him my heart. So my conclusion is the only way I'm going to be able to love my wife is if I give God my heart. I told Trucker this week that I loved him. He didn't know how to take that. He was taken back by that. Actually, it was two of them standing together, and I told them both I loved them. But I was able to tell them, I love you because the Lord has given me a love for you. Boy, they got fidgety. I mean, they got fidgety. They started looking down, started kicking the ground. I mean, they got fidgety. Grown men don't know how to take that, you know. Charity never fails. Whether they're prophecies, they'll fail. Knowledge puffs up, but charity never fails. Heavenly Father, I thank you today for your word. I thank you, Lord, for wanting my heart. I don't know why you did.